Welcome to this video cast for worship put together by Whitley Bay Baptist Church, where I'm the pastor, and my name's Paul Newman. Please accept a very warm welcome from our fellowship, whether you're a regular part of it, or whether you've just accidentally clicked a button and found yourself in this remote corner of YouTube. You are very welcome. It's our hope and prayer that as we share in worship, pray, read the scripture and reflect on it, that you will be drawn close to our Lord Jesus Christ and be encouraged in following him. Today, we're considering the place of the Lord Jesus in our life of faith and our working it out every day. In his letter to the Philippians, the Apostle Paul encourages us to build relationships with one another, having the same mindset as Christ himself, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. He was made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's pray. Almighty God, we gather alone together to worship you. We are one with all your people in heaven and on earth, to lift up our voices and give you the praise and honour due to you, our God and King, is our delight. And as we do so, we want to confess Jesus as Lord. We want to celebrate the supremacy of Jesus in a world that has reduced him to just a moral teacher. We want to praise Jesus for his uniqueness, his ultimacy, and his deity. Jesus, we praise you for the uniqueness of your name. We worship you because you are our advocate in heaven, the bread of life, the consolation of Israel, the door to pastures new, Emmanuel, God with us, the friend of sinners, our great high priest, the Holy One, image of the invisible God, judge of all, King of kings, Lord of glory, mighty God, the one and only Son of Yahweh, the Prince of Peace and Righteous God, the Saviour of the world, and our true vine. We praise you for your character and confess you, Jesus, as the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Lord Jesus, with countless others, we praise you today. We bring a sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord as we confess your name with our lips. And we stand in awe of you, praying that you may give each of us all we need to receive through your Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's continue in worship as the music group leads us in singing Stuart Townend's version of The Lord's My Shepherd.
Thank you.
To have that reminder that we have one who cares for us in that way. Now Jane Shaw is going to read for us from Matthew chapter 7, our gospel reading for today, and then Marjorie and Paul Newton will lead us in our prayers of intercession and the Lord's Prayer.
This reading is taken from Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 29, the New Jerusalem Bible. According to Matthew's Gospel, Jesus concluded his Sermon on the Mount with these words: "Therefore, everyone who listens to these words of mine and acts on them will be like a sensible man who built his house on rock. Rain came down, floods rose, gales blew and hurled themselves against that house, and it did not fall. It was founded on rock. But everyone who listens to these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a stupid man who built his house on sand. Rain came down, floods rose, gales blew and struck that house and it fell. And what a fall it had." Jesus had now finished what he wanted to say, and his teaching made a deep impression on the people because he taught them with authority, unlike their own scribes. Amen.
Good morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can come before you and bring our prayers, confident that you, the God who loves us so much that you gave your Son for us, will hear our prayers and answer them.
As we meet in our individual homes in Whitley Bay, the North East and beyond, we are united as your church and with your people throughout the world. The impact of the coronavirus affects us all, but love unites us all as we pray for our neighbours, both near and far. The Apostle Paul wrote of this love which bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things, love which never ends.
We think about our brothers and sisters throughout the world living in poverty in Africa, South America and Asia. Please protect countries where there is already devastation because of conflict, natural disasters, and may your church be salt and light in this dark time. At this period of unlocking, we pray for your wisdom and your guidance. We pray for our government and for all those who are taking decisions at national and local levels. We remember the scientists working on a vaccine and researchers analysing data and researching trends.
We remember again the health and care workers. Please give them resources, stamina and rest to continue in their work. We pray for those who work in education to make wise decisions as schools reopen to increasingly greater numbers of children and young people. We remember too families continuing to homeschool. We pray for our neighbours, for those who live in the doors and streets around us. Father God, help us to be salt and light in the place where you have planted us. We thank you for the increased interaction many of us have had with our neighbours and give thanks for those who have been able to have opportunities to share their faith. Please continue to grow and bless these relationships.
In Romans, we read, "For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." Living God, give strength and peace and comfort to the brokenhearted. We think of those who are bereaved and are grieving, thinking especially of the family of Nan Kirkland, whose funeral will be held on Friday. We think of those who are sick and continue in prayer for Esther, Ian and the children, and for those who are also in need of recovery and healing at this time. We pray for those experiencing anxiety and poor mental health as the pandemic progresses, for those who have been isolated in their homes for many weeks, and those who are fearful of going out. Be their strength, be their guide, their wisdom and hope.
Again, the Apostle Paul writes, "Beloved, let us love one another, encourage one another and build one another up." Father God, we pray for our church here in Whitley Bay, thanking you for each other and the fellowship we share together. Please continue to bless and equip Paul and Jill as they move house and into this next phase of retirement. We pray for the church leadership team as they take decisions both for the short and long term. Oh Lord, how we long to be your people praising you together in your house. Please give wisdom and patience until that day comes. We thank you for the many small groups within the church and for the technology which allows us to meet, albeit virtually. We think especially this week of Take Five and Chat and the pastoral care teams. Thank you for the ways they have found to communicate with and support those in need. We bring all these prayers to you in the name of your precious Son, who taught us when we pray to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down, and the floods came up, splash! The rains came down, and the floods came up, splash! The rains came down, and the floods came up, splash! And the house on the rock stood firm. Well, I'm sure you'll agree that's quite enough of that. It comes to a person when they've not had their hair cut for 3 months, you know. But the opening verse of that Christian nursery rhyme that some of us learned when we were very young indeed is based on some of the most profound words we find in the Gospels and that were read to us earlier by Jane. Even though what it says is simple, it's not really a ditty for the entertainment of children, young and old, but is one of the key principles of the kingdom of God presented at the end of those three chapters of Matthew's Gospel that we call the Sermon on the Mount. In those pages, Jesus maps out the agenda for his ministry. He says, "Those who hear me and follow me will live like this." And it's the very foundation of living in and for God. On the other hand, you can ignore what I'm teaching you and choose your own foundations, but it'll be the difference between building on a sure foundation of rock compared with building on the bare sand. Over the last 3 months, Jill and I have taken many walks on the beach at Whitley Bay and long sands at Tynemouth. Every time the experience is different because depending on the height of the tide and the force of the winds driving the waves, the beaches are sculpted differently. One day, there may be a great mound of sand stretching many, many yards, with a lower bit behind it still holding a quantity of seawater that could not escape when the tide went out. Another day, the sand has been transported away, revealing a wide expanse of shingle and stone. And yet a couple of days later, there's a lovely sandy stretch of beach with not a rock to be seen. Yet later, the same week, rocky outcrops sit begging for children to come and climb on them. Those rocky outcrops were there all the while, sometimes covered by the sand, but at other times very clearly there. Those rocks do not move as the tide comes and goes. They're able to provide a sure foundation, but not the moving sand. Jesus says, "Listen carefully to what I teach and build on it, put it into action. Join me in building the kingdom of God." History teaches us that culture changes, fashion changes, economics change, politics change, society changes, and health changes. Our sense of morality changes. Reality also teaches us that the human race is exceptionally good at not learning from history. So what should we build on? What is sure and steadfast and unchanging? What is utterly dependable, good and true? And God, through Jesus, says, "I am. I'm here to be your prophet to teach you about God. I'm here to be your priest so you can be one with God and with one another. I'm here to be the king of the kingdom. What's more, I'm here to be your companion and guide, especially when the world looks like a wilderness." The prophet is a messenger sent by God, a person who speaks for God. A prophet witnesses to God, calls people to turn to God's ways, and may also foretell the future. Prophets, we discover as we read the Old Testament, are often killed for their message. In the Gospels, we discover that Jesus fits this description. He is none other than the Word of God. He calls the world to turn from its sin. Such a little word to describe our habitual tendency to go our own way that leads to breakdown and warfare and destruction. Last time I spoke about the difficult call to forgiveness. Not just to receive God's forgiveness that we all need if we're to live the abundant lives promised by the gospel, but to give it in grace, without ties, unconditionally to others. Turn away from sin, says the prophet Jesus. and forgive. And he was put to death for it. A priest is a mediator, a bridge between God and human beings. In the Gospels, we discover Jesus is one who is exactly that. In the Old Testament sense of the word, a priest is one who offers sacrifice to God on behalf of all. The Jews of Jesus' time believed they were okay with God. They were his people, called out of Egypt and fed in the wilderness, and their future was secure in him. But their lives, individually and corporately, were marred by sin, and so once a year, on the Day of the Atonement, the high priest went into the Holy of Holies to offer a sacrifice to God to make up for his own sins and the sins of the people. Deal done. The priest Jesus is, in a way too mysterious to get our heads round, is both the priest and the sacrifice. He's the way to the Father, as well as being the prophetic truth of the life of the kingdom. Ravi Zacharias once said, "The Christian faith, simply stated, reminds us that our fundamental problem is not moral. Rather, our fundamental problem is spiritual. Because a moral life alone cannot bridge what separates us from God. Herein lies the cardinal difference between the moralizing religions and Jesus' offer to us. Jesus does not offer to make bad people good, but to make dead people alive." The Jews of Jesus' day underestimated the problem of sin. They saw it as something rather unpleasant that needed sorting by making an animal sacrifice. The good news Jesus brings declares that we're not just sinners, we're dead because of our sin, dead to relationship with God. And that needs more than a sacrificial death of a lamb to put things right. It needs a resurrection from the dead. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Jesus is prophet, and he's priest, and he's king. A king is a person who has supreme authority over a territory. When the Jewish people were ruled by kings, they became a nation. And when the shine went off that, they longed for a Messiah, a Christ who would make them great again. Jesus is spoken of as a king in the Gospels. The angel Gabriel announced to Mary that the Lord God would give her son the throne of David. And he would rule on that throne forever. Wise men looked for a newborn king of the Jews and found him in the stable at Bethlehem. When 30 years later he entered Jerusalem, crowds hailed him as the king who would save them. Hosanna in the highest. When he was nailed to the cross, they wrote the charge down and had it nailed to the cross with him. Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. Jesus announced the kingdom of God. His mission was that God should reign in the hearts of all people, not just the Jews, but all people. And for the world to be transformed into a reality characterized by love and peace and justice. And this he did. As servant king. James S. Stewart, an Edinburgh preacher of a previous generation, describes Jesus like this: "He was the meekest and lowliest of all the sons of men, yet he spoke of coming on the clouds of heaven with the glory of God. He was so austere that evil spirits and demons cried out in terror at his coming. yet he was so genial and winsome and approachable that the children loved to play with him and the little ones nestled in his arms. His presence at the innocent gaiety of a village wedding was like the presence of sunshine. No one was half so compassionate to sinners, yet no one ever spoke such red-hot, scorching words about sin as he. A bruised reed he would not break. His whole life was love. Yet on one occasion he demanded of the Pharisees how they ever expected to escape the damnation of hell. He was a dreamer of dreams and a seer of visions. Yet for sheer stark realism, he has all of our stark realists soundly beaten. He was a servant of all, washing the disciples' feet. Yet masterfully he strode into the temple, and the hucksters and the money changers over one another to get away from the mad rush and the fire they saw blazing in his eyes. He saved others, yet at the last himself he did not save. There is nothing in history like the union of contrasts which confronts us in the Gospels. The mystery of Jesus is the mystery of divine personality. And where do we discover this? Primarily in the Gospels. And I'm not sure that those of us who call ourselves evangelicals spend enough time reading the accounts of Jesus given us by the four evangelists, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John. In New Testament times, when a person followed a rabbi, a teacher, they moved in to live with that rabbi and ate what the rabbi ate and read what the rabbi read and discussed what the rabbi was teaching and sought to imitate the rabbi in his habits and behaviours. And in the Gospels, we're invited to follow the rabbi, who is Jesus Christ. If we want to know Jesus, then we need to be immersed in the four Gospels so that when we pray according to what we have discovered is important to him. When we speak of the things that are important to him. And in our manner, we will constantly be seeking the Holy Spirit to make us like him. Then, when we approach the rest of Scripture, we'll come to it constantly seeking Jesus. The God of the Old Testament is the God of the Gospels and the God of the Epistles, but we come to know him through the Gospels, which were written to present him to us. Churches of more liturgical traditions than ours often use a lectionary which provides three Bible readings for every service. One from the Old Testament, one from the New Testament, and a passage from the Gospels. And the Gospel reading is always given the primary place, because this is where we have the most direct witness to Jesus and his teaching. As Tom Wright has written, the risen Jesus at the end of Matthew's Gospel does not say all authority in heaven and on earth is given to the books you're all going to write about me, but all authority in heaven and on earth is given to me. Jesus is God's authority and God's word to us. I want to know Jesus with all my heart, soul, mind and strength, and love my neighbour as Jesus does. Do you? Are you daily building on the rock? Let's pray for a moment. God our Father, bring us back to Jesus day by day. Let us learn the Gospels so well that their story will keep speaking into our hearts and minds, our soul and our strength. Just as that little song, "The Wise Man Built His House Upon the Rock," becomes one of those little tunes that goes round and round in our mind and cannot be shaken away. So, Lord, there is so much else in the Gospel that we need to hear and that we need to stick. Sometimes we run away from the teaching of Jesus because it seems too hard. And it becomes easier to have theological debates about what Paul might be saying about the mechanics of salvation. But it is Jesus we need to know. For it is he who is our companion through the Holy Spirit and our teacher. The one who is always ready to listen. The one who is always ready to feed his sheep and guide them by still waters. So be real for us, Lord Jesus. Reveal yourself to us, Lord Jesus. Give us the courage to follow on day by day. In your name we ask it. Amen. And now the music group is going to lead us in the great Irish hymn of commitment to Christ, "Be Thou My Vision."
Be Thou My Vision, O Lord of my heart, naught be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Heart of my own heart, my vision, O ruler of all.
Amen. Let us pray. To your name, Lord Jesus, help us to bow the knee and all its worshipping, to bow the head and all its thinking, to bow the will and all its choosing, to bow the heart and all its loving. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.